Welcome back to I'm Still Here. I'm Larry.
And I'm Heather. In 1998, at the age of 26, I was diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer. It changed everything for us, but I'm still here.
Yep.
And today we're talking about some treatment or overall cancer hacks, cheats, ways to maybe like let your day go a little bit better when you're doing all these fun things, right?
For sure. I mean, and that's definitely one of the things that I think you would learn anyway. So why not learn these things before? Or you can give somebody else this advice if you're listening to this podcast and you hear about this. Certainly none of these things we're going to give you are going to hurt in any way.
And yeah, I think it's better to learn them from somebody than learn them the hard way.
Or at the end, you know, you're like, why wasn't I doing this the whole time?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So they're good. Yeah. What do you got for number one?
Number one is hydrate. So hydrate before procedures. Obviously, sometimes there's timelines on things, but it's a lot easier to get an IV in when you have hydrated. Hydrate after procedures. I actually just got my medicine today. And so I know that it's better to hydrate, get that moving around, all that kind of stuff. So drink your water, people.
Just in general, our body works better when the optimal level of fluids are in it. Not only that, in a lot of your treatments, you're not going to feel like doing much, right?
Right.
I mean, you're not going to be eating much. It's easy just to not drink water too. Mm-hmm. And because you just don't feel like it. But boy, I mean, you got to remember, everything is going to work better. The medicine, everything is going to be more efficient and more effective if you're hydrated.
Yeah, and I would say kind of maybe a sub-hack of that is that what you just alluded to, especially on the days that you're feeling good, like get the water in you because there are going to be days that you're not going to be. So, you know, again, You can hydrate less if you just can't choke it down. But, man, on the days you're feeling good, take advantage of it, right?
And the days you're feeling really crappy, and including vomiting and stuff like that, boy, you got to get some fluids in you.
Yeah.
You got to try to keep them in.
Yeah, I mean, I guess for that, I use other things, right? Like, that's when I will go to, like, Body Armor or Gatorade or things like that. It's just easier for me to get it down. So, yeah.
Number two.
Wear comfy clothes.
So you're not going for an interview?
Not going for an interview. Yeah. If you can see me right now, I'm wearing leggings and a sweatshirt. This would be pretty appropriate for a lot of the things I do. However, I would be considering what type of appointment I'm going to, because I might want to wear a sweatshirt that zips up so I can take it off easily. It just depends.
Or sometimes not a sweatshirt with a zipper.
Right, because I don't want any metal.
Mm-hmm.
All of those things are really important. Jewelry sometimes needs to be taken off. I don't particularly like to take my ring and necklace and things like that off in the hospital and give them to somebody. So just a little
Which
bit.
Which she's done 75 times.
Oh, a million times. Okay. This is the learn it the hard way.
Yes. Situation. Things in my pocket are not the safest things in the world. So
leave them at home. But again, just thinking about if you're accessing a port, is it good to have a button up? How are you going to get to the port? All of those kind of things. If you're doing tests that, you know, a lot of times they've told you to change into a gown, it's because they don't want you to have metal on. So if you don't wear metal, you know, and they can get to an IV spot, you're probably going to be able to wear your comfortable clothes, which is so much better,
and if you're just going in for, say, chemotherapy or something like that, wear comfortable clothes.
You're
not there to impress anybody. You are there to be comfortable, including what you're wearing on your feet.
Yeah.
Something you can kick off really easy and put back on. All of those things are great calls.
I agree. Yeah. I agree. And remember, hospitals are cold.
They are. Overdressed.
So, overdressed, yes.
That is true.
I hate, it's like,
especially when you're doing treatment. Yeah. Everything is colder.
Yeah. Hospitals and airplanes. Burr. Yeah. So, in movie theaters.
Number three.
Don't schedule around other events if you can. We've talked a little bit about this, right?
Yep. So, what do you mean?
Like, there's a certain amount of anxiety that comes with scheduling appointments that have to do with cancer, right? So I just find that if I can either have them done and out of the way well before, or just not having to think about them, kind of be in that whole everything's great period of time.
So we're not talking about treatment here. We're talking about tests and appointments.
Yeah, okay. I would say also with that, I think it's so easy to get into that thought that, like, whatever they tell me, like, oh, this is the appointment time, like, there's no flexibility with that. And that's, other than chemo is not very flexible, right? It's once every 3 weeks and pretty regimented.
For
you. You can sometimes take a week off or whatever. But it's okay also to ask or to say, man, my family's getting together that day or whatever that looks like, you know.
Some things are hard and fast for them. Some things are not. Yep. And if you don't ask, you don't know.
Mm-hmm. That's all I got about that. Number four. Allow yourself plenty of time. This is a hard one for me because I like to get to things right on time. But it does raise your stress level when you are sitting in traffic 5 minutes away from the hospital or 10 minutes away from the hospital at your appointment time, right? Mm-hmm. So just allow yourself plenty of time. You can also maneuver appointments based on how I know traffic will be. And on the flip side of that, like, I just think it goes better if you can also just kind of allow them time as well. Especially at big hospitals, like, things get behind. And I mean, if we can all just keep the mindset that they're probably working on somebody that they really need to be, or spending time with somebody that they, you know, it's not that they're trying to be behind in that situation. And some hospitals are also super great at catching up. So it doesn't really matter. It's just easier to kind of get there early, know that you might be there for a long time. You know, don't overschedule yourself in that respect.
And that this is something we did learn the hard way. We just thought everything ran, you know, in a certain way. And after about, I don't know, a month or two of going there and doing things, we realized, oh no, that is not how it works. At least at the hospital we went to.
Yeah.
And once we got into the mindset of expecting it to be behind.
Yeah.
And them understanding that they did have a good reason for being behind. Yeah. It wasn't because they were taking extra coffee breaks.
Right.
They were spending the extra 15 minutes with that patient that was just newly diagnosed and answering questions.
Or talking about progression.
Yeah, and it's things like that. You know what? That's why they're there. And we would want that extra time if it were us. Have some grace and just go in going, you know what? We're going to be here. Don't schedule something. You know, if you got your doctor's appointment at 1, don't schedule this important lunch at 2.
Right.
Don't do that to yourself. Right. You know,
likewise,
schedule it at 4.
If you're scheduling other appointments in the hospital, you know, there is sometimes some leeway with that too. So you can always, you know, can I still do this? Or can you call them? A lot of times if we knew we were running way behind, and they would do that, and it was never a problem to go to that next appointment then. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's so anxiety inducing, and it really can be kind of alleviated with the right conversations and planning.
Yeah. Which I think number 5 can also alleviate that.
Number 5 is bring the right person. So bring the person that you're comfortable with. Bring the person that you don't have to entertain. Bring the person who can advocate for you if you need it. Bring the right person for the job. And sometimes it's the right, you know, you're like, I would say you're my top person in that. Like, you can do all of those things. But I have other people who can do some of those things, maybe, you know. And so depending on what the day looks like, you know, that's fine. But
and maybe, you know, it's 8 hours of chemo and she doesn't want to talk to me for 8 hours.
Yeah.
You know, other people can come too. That's the thing, you know. It, now, she was like 8 hours of chemo. Some people I know are doing an hour or two.
Yeah.
And, but maybe that is taking somebody else when...
Sure.
You know what it's going to be now and going, you know what, maybe they'll come with me this time.
And, yeah.
You know, you can have that reason. They don't even need to know that. And
And sometimes it can even be a break if it's your primary caregiver, right? If for them to know that you're in good hands with somebody else and they can, you know, go to work or relax or do something that's, you know, not completely cancer related, might be a good thing.
For sure. Yep.
Yeah.
Number 6.
get the things you need at home prior to whatever's happening. So I think this is a little more related to things like surgery or procedures, but it's helpful to have this, you know, have your fridge stocked a little bit, have the, you know, ibuprofen, Tylenol, things like that, have the Gatorade after chemo or whatever that is. Just if you can do those things prior to, you're not sending somebody out, you're not trying to make decisions, you're just, you can kind of just slide back into home and feel better about it.
And if you're working at the same time, that goes hand in hand with this. Try to tie up those things that you know are pressing. Not always possible, but try to give yourself a couple of days of where you can coast, or maybe not coast, maybe even to days off where they don't even need you as far as a phone call or something like that.
Yep.
If you can get those things organized, both the home, school, job, boring, whatever that is, it's going to be a little more pleasant for you, for sure.
I agree. Number 7. This is also something that I've learned the hard way. Mm-hmm. Read the instructions, not the night before, but like maybe...
Read the instructions for what?
For an upcoming test or procedure.
Yes.
The thing is now you have these nifty little portals, and when it says your appointment time, it also says...
A whole bunch of words under that.
A bunch of other stuff. And like, you know, I do PET scans, and... They recommend no exercise for 48 hours prior. So, like, not, you know, like, I have done that in the past. I know I've walked 48 hours prior. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So,
now, once you've done it or once you have read it, it's going to be the same each time.
Right.
But actually,
that's changed over the... I think that recommendation has changed
over the last 20 years, but not a month from now.
No, right. But, yeah, know what you're getting into. I mean, again, the last thing you want is to have needed to fast for some sort of situation and get there and go, nope.
If you got that person in your life that wants to, that can take that on.
Yes.
And say, no, I'll do all the pre stuff for you. I'll make sure this and that, and I'll summarize it for you, and this is what you got to know. Oh, wow. That would be awesome.
Yeah.
You know, that can be a load off of you, and
you
don't have to worry about that stuff. Some people just are wanting to just tell me what to do.
Yeah, for
and
sure.
And some people want to read and...
Well, I don't want to read. If you want to read my...
I don't.
Okay.
I'm not that person. I'm telling you right now. Yeah.
Shoot.
But some people have that person.
Darn it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. Number 8. You want to tell?
Well, we didn't have this. So this is not from our experience, but it for sure would be what we would do now. If we had the same scenario, if we were just leapfrogged to now, we'd find, because we have a 2 to 2.5 hour drive to get to the hospital that we go to or did go to.
Yeah.
So we would either get a good podcast or a series of podcasts. Maybe they've already released a whole bunch and a topic that is appropriate, because that matters when you're going through treatment. Sometimes they throw curveballs at you and you're like, oh, this is really uncomfortable that we're listening to this right now based on what we're about ready to do. Maybe it's just...
Side note on that. At some point, I'm going to do like some sort of pre-approved book club. We could do podcasts and things like that that are not going to send you down rabbit holes of, oh my gosh, this person, you know.
Sure. Maybe it's funny. Maybe that's what you need. A lot of times we were leaving here at 4 a.m., 6 a.m. for the drive down there. Maybe it is. Maybe you just want to sleep. You know, it's different for everybody, but it's amazing on a two-hour drive how fast it goes when you're listening to a podcast, even just listening to music.
Yeah.
Because your brain's involved in your question. We press pause a lot and talk about, you know, whatever that podcast is. So something like that. But it could be, you know, for you, you hate podcasts. What we would have done back then is... play some sort of road game or, you know, you're looking at that and find, you know, just something to pass the time, because those trips are many and they do become monotonous. So we would do something like that. And then when Heather was doing chemotherapy, it was 8 to 10 hours a session down there. So, you know, there was no phones, there was no, you know, screen phones. And so now we would, you know, get a Netflix series or another podcast. And whether that's just her zoning out listening to it or us listening or watching it together. They have TVs, obviously, but, you know, we were just, yeah. So she would do crosswords. She would do other things. I would grade papers. But now they're just technologies, leaps and bounds. You could have a bigger screen and sit it right there. It's just plan that stuff.
Yeah, I think one of the things I was going to say is that it's sometimes fun to have maybe do a series that you only watch when you're there or something like that. Mm-hmm. Just like I do that too with the treadmill, right? Like this is a show I really want to watch, but I'm only going to watch it when I'm on the treadmill. So it's sort of...
But just think it through. And if somebody else has watched it... Maybe say, hey, would that be a good thing for me to watch while I'm doing chemo? You know, that kind of things. Yeah. Because there are. When you're in the moment, you don't want to watch bad things happen to people. You just don't.
Yeah. Keep it light, right?
So, and I bet there's other things that we haven't because we didn't do all those things, but we would do it now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Number nine.
Going back to chemo, just ask about the timing. Like, we were talking about the fact that I didn't know anything about chemo, so I really thought I was gonna start puking immediately, which I almost did. But that was a reaction, it wasn't the truth.
Yeah.
And then just not stop. But that's really not the case. So when you're, learning about chemo and what's gonna happen, ask them about the timing of things in terms of, will I feel, when will I start feeling not as good? That's all based on your counts dropping and things like that. So a lot of times people really do feel pretty good the next day or next couple days, and then it drops off from there. So all of that, you might be able to coordinate it so that you do go to work the next day if you're working, or maybe the next couple days, and then that, when you're not feeling good, that's a weekend. Whatever that looks like for you.
Saying chemo is like saying cancer.
Yeah, there's so many different ones,
and then there's so many different regimens of that same chemotherapy. Yeah. If you're getting chemo every day over a 20-day period, but that's the one chemotherapy, it's going to be a much different way you feel and how you react to you're getting it once a week or once every 2 weeks, but you're getting much more of it, it's going to be different. Guess who knows the answer to these? The nurses. The nurses know, and they'll the experienced ones, the ones that have been doing this for 20 years, they know to the day. And they know, and it's also different if you're 30 years old and doing the same exact regimen as a 68-year-old.
Yeah.
Those are two different things, but the nurses still know. They know, for the most part, how people are going to react. And they are just a wealth of knowledge that you can tap into, and they will answer those and to the best of their ability. Ask those questions, though, before you even start.
Yeah.
You have access to that.
I would say that's true also for surgery and recovery, right?
Yeah.
Like, be clear on what, are you going to have weight restrictions? How long is that going to be? What does that look like,
Yeah.
What's coming your way? It's better to know. I think a lot of times we don't ask questions and then we worry about the things we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So.
So true.
Yeah. All right. Number 10. The big one. This is my...
This is the big one?
No.
Oh, God.
No, this is just kind of... not to be funny, but Valium is your friend. Mm-hmm. So you don't need to tough it out when you're doing all of these treatments. They do make medicines to help you relax. We were thinking about, I do not do well in MRIs, so I do take something to relax, and bring a driver with me, Same thing for radiation, can feel overwhelming, claustrophobic. Sometimes you have to have, you can't move, so you have to have everything really pinned down. It's not a great feeling. So use the medication that's that's available.
And in the same sense, this just hit me, is it's okay to say timeout.
Yeah.
Timeout. Yep. Wait a minute. I need to fix this. This is not going to work.
Yeah.
They do this every day.
Yeah.
They can help with that.
Yeah.
Don't tough it out. I totally agree. Don't tough it out.
Yeah.
You're not there to be tough.
Well, and even like when you're doing it, like anything, a CAT scan or an MRI or whatever, they can, you can push the button when the MRI thing, they can hear you if you say something in a CAT scan.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Yeah, I think we, again, just, and that gives you those feelings of just, oh, I hated that. And maybe you didn't have to hate it, right? It's like,
yeah, and everybody's different. I go into MRI and it's just like relax time for me. It's wonderful. The music's going. I shut my eyes. I just wander off. I can still hear them, and you know, but oh, but where other people, it's like, that is the worst thing ever. So I don't really understand that, but I do get how people feel that claustrophobia.
You know, I'll say the thing is with that, too, like when I've had MRIs, I've had like full MRIs, mm-hmm. head to toe. Mm-hmm. And sometimes,
that's a long time.
A long time. and they'll, with and without contrast, so they even pull you out halfway, you know. Yeah. So it's those are tough things. But,
those can help you.
Those can help.
Or somebody that you're listening to this and you have a friend going through stuff. Maybe one of these things is like, oh, that I should tell them that. Well, do. Pick up the phone or send them a text. Just say, you heard this from Heather. And we are things we're working on to help with these is, you know, which was mentioned if you, I don't know which.
It was
last week or something.
Yeah, last week. What did you guys think? Our 100th episode.
Yeah. We mentioned the fact that you're starting these meditations.
Yeah.
And something like that could be a treatment cheat for, it definitely absolutely would have been for you.
Yeah.
Whether that's before, during, or after, or all three.
Right.
That can be not only a calming, but it can be a focusing. And focusing your mind on things that can be effective, there's, you know, the sky's the limit there.
I agree. Yeah. I agree. So, all right. Also, this is the plan, people.
Okay.
We're going on vacation. There will be no podcast next week. We are taking the week off.
Wow.
Wow. So, again.
We are leaving right now, by the way.
Good time to catch up on old episodes. Or pass these on, share them with somebody else. You can go listen to Ty's music. You can do whatever you want. I mean, obviously, you can do whatever you want.
But. Thank you, Heather.
But don't freak out that we're not going to be here next week.
Yep.
So.
I didn't know this.
I know. It's a surprise. I like to surprise you sometimes.
She says this, and there's going to be a podcast next week. Watch. We might see you next week.
Have a great one.
Bye.